Hi guys, welcome back to the Rock at Home Summer Edition. I hope you guys are having a fantastic time, having a break from school and enjoying. It's kind of been cooler and rainy outside, but hopefully you've been having lots of fun. I hope you're having fun still with our Caption This contest. I'm loving all the photos that I'm getting in, so make sure to keep sending those in. And now our caption for this coming week is movie night, okay? So make sure to keep sending in those photos. I love seeing them. So now we are going to go sing our first song. So let's go sing Lord, I Lift Your Name on High. Okay, so remember last week we were learning about Paul's third missionary journey. We've learned about all of his different missionary journeys and the many different places he went to, and now he's on his third missionary journey. And we also learned about how God had called him to go back to Jerusalem, even though he was probably going to get arrested when he went there. And many people warned Paul about this. They also said, if you go to Jerusalem, you're going to get arrested. But Paul knew that it's what God wanted him to do, and so he was obedient to God, even though so many people didn't understand or thought that he was kind of crazy for wanting to go somewhere that he was probably going to get arrested. Paul decided to follow God, not these other people. And that's what we should do as well. Sometimes people are going to tell you to do the opposite of what God is telling you to do. But it is so important that we remember that we listen to God, not to other people. So Paul went back to Jerusalem, and when he arrived there, there were people who were very excited to see him. Some of the believers that he had met when he had been there before were so excited to see him and hear him preach. But there were a lot of people who were not happy that Paul had gone back there. And remember how we've been learning about how Paul was teaching that you needed to trust in Jesus to be saved? Remember that it used to be that you had to follow all of these Jewish laws. Back in the Old Testament, you had to give these sacrifices to get forgiveness from your sins. But Jesus came and he changed that. And so Paul was teaching about how all we need to do is put our trust in Jesus. But the Jewish people and the Jewish leaders and religious leaders at the time, they still didn't understand this. They still thought that you had to follow all the rules and make sure that you were really good and just follow the law perfectly in order to be saved. So when Paul was teaching the opposite of this, when he was saying, no, it's not about following the rules, it's about putting your trust in Jesus, that made the religious leaders very unhappy. And so they did not like Paul and what he was teaching. So they actually decided to come up with a plan on how to get Paul arrested or even killed. Now, does that sound familiar to you? Jewish leaders, religious leaders trying to get someone killed or arrested because they don't like what they're teaching? That reminds me exactly of what they did to Jesus. Jesus was also teaching that you had to put your faith and your trust in God and you had to love him with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. It wasn't about following all the rules, and the Jewish leaders hated that. They did not like it. And so that's why they arrested him and killed him. And so they're doing the same thing here with Paul. They didn't like what he was teaching, so they're planning to kill him. And so one day, Paul was at the temple and he was teaching, and a group of people came over, dragged him out of the temple, and tried to kill him. That is pretty terrifying. Let's watch the video to find out what happens to Paul.
The Apostle Paul told people the good news about Jesus wherever he went. When he returned to Jerusalem, the believers were glad to see him. But many Jews did not like that Paul taught people they don't have to follow Jewish laws to be saved. So these Jews made a plan to stop Paul. Paul was at the temple when a crowd of people dragged him away and tried to kill him. But a Roman official came and stopped them. The official arrested Paul and brought him to the Sanhedrin, a powerful group of Jewish priests and other leaders. Their job was to decide if a person had broken a Jewish law, and if so, to decide how that person should be punished. Paul stood in front of the Sanhedrin and looked the men in the eyes. "Friends," he said, "I have done what God wants me to do. I do not believe I have done anything wrong." Paul explained that he had been arrested because he taught that Jesus' resurrection gave hope that we all can be resurrected. The men in the Sanhedrin began arguing. Some of them thought dead people would be resurrected at the end of time, and others thought that would not happen. The Roman soldiers took Paul away to keep him safe. The next night, the Lord stood by Paul and gave him an incredible message. "Have courage," he said. "You told about me in Jerusalem. I want you to tell about me in Rome too." In the morning, a group of Jews got together and made a plan to kill Paul. They promised to not eat or drink until Paul was dead. These men told the Jewish leaders about their plan. Paul's nephew overheard this evil plan. He hurried to tell Paul what was going on. Paul told his nephew to report it to the commander. The army commander said, "Don't tell anyone that you told me about this plan." Then the commander told two of his officers to get together a large group of soldiers and horses. They brought a horse for Paul to ride on. And that night, the soldiers took Paul to Caesarea to see the governor. Even when others threatened his life, Paul continued to obey Jesus. He believed that God, who showed his love for the world by sending his son to die on the cross and rise again, would help him through hard times. We too can risk everything to share the gospel with courage because we know that God loves us and will care for us.
So this group of people had dragged Paul out of the temple and tried to kill him. But then a Roman guard came over and stopped them from doing it, and he ended up arresting Paul and taking him to the Sanhedrin. Now, that's kind of a funny word that we don't really hear a whole lot. What on earth is the Sanhedrin? Well, the Sanhedrin was a group of religious leaders who were really powerful and really important, and they decided whether you had broken the Jewish rules and laws or not. So it was almost kind of like a court system and judges, but it was specifically for the Jewish law. It wasn't about like the rules that you had to obey in the town that you were in. It was just for the Jewish people. And so this Roman guard took Paul to the Sanhedrin, and he stood before them, and they too were not really happy with what Paul had been doing. But he said to them, "I have not done anything wrong. I am following God." Because remember what I said earlier, Paul was following what God wanted him to do. But that didn't mean that all the people were going to like it, right? Just because we do what God wants us to do doesn't mean that people are always going to like it or agree with it. And sometimes we have to make that tough decision to follow God, even though it means other people aren't going to like it or even going to like us very much. And so Paul had done what was right in the eyes of the Lord, and that was all that mattered. But the Sanhedrin still didn't really like what he was doing. So after Paul left the Sanhedrin, the Roman officer took him away to keep him safe, and he took him away, and the religious leaders still weren't happy with him. Like, nothing had happened. Their plan hadn't happened yet. He hadn't really been arrested and thrown in prison. He hadn't been killed yet. And so they continued to try and plan to kill him. And they actually said that they weren't going to eat or drink until Paul was dead. Okay, who thinks that's a little bit dramatic? I think that's very dramatic. But have you guys ever been a little bit dramatic like that and said something crazy to like really prove your point? Like, maybe a friend has made you angry and you've said to them, "I'm never gonna talk to you ever again." But then you probably did like the very next day. Or maybe you're doing something, you're watching TV, and your parents have asked you to go clean your room up, and you've said, "I am not moving from this spot ever." You definitely did, though. You got off the couch at some point. You had to go to the bathroom. You had to get food. You had to continue living your life. These type of things remind me of what the Jewish leaders were saying. They were making like a big, drastic, dramatic statement to prove how serious they were. They were saying, "We aren't going to eat or drink until Paul is dead," which I don't think was a very wise or truthful thing to say, because we know that Paul did not die that day. God still had plans for him, and he wanted Paul to go to Rome and preach the good news to Rome just as he did in Jerusalem. And God had trusted Paul with going to Jerusalem, even though it was tough, and Paul had obeyed. And so now God had a bigger plan and a bigger step for him. He wanted him to go to Rome, which was like the really big city at that point. It would be like you going to like New York City and like proclaiming the gospel there. So it was like a big step for Paul to make. So God told him that he wanted him to go to Rome, and this wasn't the end of his story. And so after Paul's nephew had overheard this plan from the Jewish religious leaders to kill him, he told Paul and then told the Roman guard, who was able then to get Paul a horse and get him out of Jerusalem. And he sent him off to Caesarea, and he's going to stand before the governor, which is also pretty crazy as well. Like, he was a big, important person. And that is the end of the story for today. There is so much more to learn, but we're having a bit of a cliffhanger, and we're not actually going to find out what happens to Paul for a few weeks now, because for the next few weeks, we're going to talk about some of the letters that Paul wrote as well. So stay tuned. We are going to learn more about Paul and his story and what on earth happens to him in Caesarea. So now we are going to go sing our second song. We're going to go sing Jump. So make sure you get up on your feet and do all the actions, because this is a super fun one.
Jump, 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 jump grace. God's word is alive and it is here in this place. It's in our music, yeah. In our praises, yeah. Machine. Stomp your feet and make the room go thump. Everybody get up and jump.
Okay, guys, it is time for, you guessed it, questions from kids. And today's question, we actually have two different questions today, but they went together so well, so I wanted to answer them together. So our questions for today are from Titus C. and Abigail C. And they ask, why is the New Testament the last testament and the Old Testament the first? Why are there two testaments and not just one? Good questions, you guys. I really like these questions. These are things that I've never really thought about before. I kind of just always assumed and accepted that, you know, there were two testaments and they came in a certain order. So these are really good questions, and I'm excited to talk to you more about the Bible and why it's structured the way that it is. So we know that the Bible is split up into these two sections that we just talked about, the Old Testament and the New Testament, and then it's also split up into a bunch of different books. Do you guys remember how many books there are in the Bible? Say it with me. There are 66 books in the Bible, and then there are 39 books in the Old Testament, and there are 27 books in the New Testament. And because the Bible is split up in this very unique way, we have our two different testaments, all of our different books, and then there's different chapters in each book, and then different verses in each chapter. It's all split up in a very unique way. And because it's split up like this, I think sometimes we forget that the Bible is actually one big story. The whole Bible tells a continuous story. It tells the story of how God loves his creation and wants to be in relationship with his creation. So if the Bible is one big story, that means that there is a certain order to it, right? You don't just start reading a book. You don't pick it up and just open it in the middle and start reading it from there. That would be crazy. You wouldn't know the beginning of the story. You'd be so confused. Same when you're telling a story. If you're telling a cool story of something that happened to you, you don't start at the end. You start at the beginning. And the same is true for the Bible. The Old Testament begins with the very beginning of the entire world. That's what we read about in Genesis. And then it follows all the stories of these different people that God called, and they were a part of his plan to fulfill the big story for him to be in relationship with his creation. And so that's why the Old Testament comes first, because it's the beginning of the story. And then the New Testament comes after it because it continues the story, and it continues the story of the Old Testament and tells us the end of the story as well. Now, we don't always read the Bible like from front to back, right? We don't always sit down and read it from Genesis to Revelation. Sometimes we read just a random book here and there. Sometimes we just read a random verse. My favorite book in the Bible is James, so I've read it very many times. So I don't always just go Genesis to Revelation. Sometimes I feel like reading James today, and so I'll read the whole book of James, or sometimes we read the whole book of Ruth, or we read a Psalm or a proverb here and there. Sometimes we study just the Gospels. We study Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Sometimes we like to read the whole New Testament, maybe before we even read the Old Testament. We can still learn so much from each of these individual books, but something very important, I think that we do need to read the whole Bible from front to back, not all at once, over the course of a year or a few years, that we should all do that at some point. When I was growing up, I had a really, really hard time reading the Old Testament. I thought it was so confusing and it was kind of boring as well. So I would just read the New Testament over and over and over again. But then just a few years ago, not when I was younger, I decided that I really needed to read the entire Bible. And so I read the Old Testament all the way through until the New Testament as well. And guess what, guys? I learned so much. The big story made so much more sense to me. I understood things that I had never understood before because I finally knew the beginning of the story. Did you guys know that Jesus and the apostles actually quote the Old Testament a lot in the New Testament? You may not recognize it or have seen that before if you haven't read the Old Testament. So the Old Testament comes first because it's the beginning of the story, and then the New Testament follows because it continues the story and gives us the end of the story. So now, why are there two testaments and not just one? That's a great question. Technically, I guess there could just be one. It could just kind of be one big book that could be split up into the 66 different books, and there aren't the two different testaments. But did you guys know that there is actually a big gap in time between the end of the Old Testament and the beginning of the New Testament? There's actually 400 years in between the last part of the Old Testament that we read and the beginning of the New Testament. And we call those 400 years the 400 years of silence because God wasn't speaking directly to his people during those times. People weren't writing anything down. They weren't making new books. And so there's this big gap that kind of separates the Old Testament and the New Testament. So the people who were living in those 400 years of silence, they only had the Old Testament. Their Bible or scripture was just those 39 books because the New Testament hadn't even happened yet. People like Peter and Paul and Jesus, they hadn't even been born. So scripture and the Bible was just those 39 books. It was just the Old Testament. They didn't call it the Old Testament at that time because they didn't know that there was going to be a New Testament. That was just the Bible to them. But then, after these 400 years, something really amazing and awesome happened. The greatest thing that has ever happened in the entire world happened. Do you know what it is? Jesus was born. Jesus came to the world. Jesus was the Messiah, the Savior that everyone had been waiting for years and years and years. He was the one who was going to change everything. So we've talked about how when Jesus died on the cross and rose again, so many things changed. People no longer had to make sacrifices anymore. They didn't need to follow all of these Jewish laws. All they needed to do was to ask Jesus to come into their lives and to live for him. And that's how they were forgiven for their sins. And they could just talk to Jesus directly. They didn't have to go to the temple anymore. They didn't have to go to a special place because the Holy Spirit was living inside of them. And so that is a big part and a big separation between the Old Testament and the New Testament, because things changed so much after Jesus came. So that's one of the reasons that we have two different testaments. First, there is a big gap in between them. For a really long time, all the people had were the 39 books in the Old Testament. But then Jesus came and changed everything, and more books were written and were added to the Bible. And then we had this New Testament, and all of it together is the Bible. It is God's word that we know is true and that we can trust and we can believe everything that it says. Now, do you guys know what the word testament means? This is kind of a separate question because as I looked at Titus and Abigail's questions, it sparked questions in my mind as well. Isn't that so cool? And guess what? I didn't know what the word testament meant until just a few minutes ago when I was studying all of this. So it's so cool how some people's questions bring up more questions and then we can all learn so much together. So I Googled the answer to figure out what a testament was. And a testament is something that serves as a sign or evidence of a specified fact, event, or quality. So if that's what the word testament means, that means that the Old Testament is proof or a sign or evidence of something. And the New Testament is the newer sign or evidence or proof of something. And so I think it's so cool that the word testaments are in there, and that's what we use to describe the Bible, because the Bible is our evidence or our sign that God is real, that He exists, and that He loves us, and that He wants to have a relationship with us. Isn't that so cool? So we have older signs and evidence from thousands and thousands of years ago that prove God's existence, His love for us, and Him wanting to be in a relationship with us. And then we have newer signs and evidence as well of all of those things too. Isn't that so cool? So I learned something new today as well, and I hope you guys did too, and that you learned more about the Bible and why it's split up in the way that it is. And I really hope and encourage you guys to read the whole Bible. You might be a little bit young right now, but start working your way through it. And even if you don't understand all of it, that's okay. I still don't understand all of it as well. But as we read it more, we learn more, and we grow in our relationship with God, and we grow in our understanding of Him as well. So keep reading your Bible, keep learning more, and keep asking questions as well, okay? Keep sending in your questions for kids because I love answering them. So that is our Rock from Home lesson today. I hope you guys enjoyed it. Make sure to keep sending in your caption this question or your caption this photos. I love seeing them every week, and we will see you guys next week. Bye.